Hello everybody, it's Philippa Kelly here, resident dramaturg for the California Shakespeare Theater, speaking to you in an atmosphere of absolutely toxic smoke coming from St. Helena and the Napa Valley as California burns up. But anyway, on to Henry IV, Part 2, which I'm delighted to talk about with you today. It's possible to make the argument that Shakespeare's plays make the statement that the best possible ruler must be both anointed and politically shrewd. In the prologue to this play, the character Rumour speaks of King Henry's anointed head. But Henry's head is not anointed. He stole the crown when he assassinated Richard II, and Henry cannot reconcile himself at this late stage of his life to his thievery. Late in the play, we'll see his son gently steal the crown from off his own father's head and then put it back again. Is this son more anointed than his father was because he waits for the king to die rather than kill him? Or perhaps because he hasn't had to kill to get the throne, the prince can be anointed by public or at least audience opinion. So, in a way, is Hal's outlawish character the embodiment of the rebellion that his father, Henry, himself has caused? Is Henry's own wayward son, in other words, a parody of his father's transgressions? Hal has certainly adopted a father in Falstaff who can take the place of his biological father with a lot more obvious rascalian tendencies and a great deal more fun. Well, succession, who has the right to rule, and how authority was embodied, and what made a king or a regent somehow destined to rule, was definitely on people's minds in the 1590s when this play was written. Elizabeth I was getting older, and she was obviously too old to create an heir of her own blood. So what could and should the people of England expect of a new ruler? And here's what I think when I look at Henry IV, Part 2. Although Prince Hal's history of dissoluteness is related to the state, it's apparent that there is indeed a fresh beginning in the prince's behaviour. His conduct implies that monarchy should be viewed in a new light, in a world of uncertainties. Through a process of education, Hal is finally able to assume with competence the burden that his father's usurpation and Richard II's unworthiness have placed upon him. And that education has actually involved him being part of the people, having fun with the people, away from the court. In his gradual development from a dissolute adolescent to what looks like being a responsible king, Henry, as in Hal, dramatizes not only the political but also the personal qualities that might make a fit king. But the play is not without a great deal of fun during this journey, engineered by Falstaff, largely without his young companion in this play. And it's also not without heartbreak, as Prince Hal, or King Henry, the new King Henry, toward the play's end, rejects his old playfellow, who is disinclined to change and who doesn't want to change. And the young man turns his face away from his adopted father, toward kingship, authority, responsibility, public image that has no place for Falstaff. I know you not, old man. These words cancel out a history of friendship, of the family that has been chosen rather than the family that the young man was born to, of folly and laughter. And Falstaff, who's a figure very different from Lear's fool, but not unlike the stature of the character who only has life when he can be an adjunct to his master, goes, like Lear's fool, away to die somewhere off stage. Thank you, everybody, and I hope you stay well, and bye for now.